Greetings, beloved. I am Antoinette Bolden. Thank you for tuning in to God's Truth and Deliverance broadcast with Brother Hawk Bolden and I. We pray that during this message, the Holy Spirit will open up God's truth to you, and you will receive deliverance in every area of your life. For the Word declares in John 8:32, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." So stay tuned and be blessed by today's message.
We want to say greetings to everyone and thank you all for being here tonight. We're so grateful to the Lord for everything that He has done and the things that He is holding us up in. And we're also grateful for the opportunity that we have to come before you and share the things that God has called us to share with you tonight. Amen. So if you have your Bibles, let's go to the 10th chapter, the book of Luke. Chapter of the book of Luke. Amen. Who remember what it was that we talked about last week? Who remembers what we talked about? What was that?
I'm going back to your first love.
All right. Yeah. Getting back to your first love. In many relationships, of course, as we stated last week, people fall in love, and people experience the joys of the relationship, but of course then life happens, things come up, and you begin to be tossed by the things of this world, and sometimes if you're not careful, you can get away from nurturing the relationship. When people first start in a relationship, they are careful to nurture that relationship. They are careful to give it attention, and the attention that it needs to survive. A lot of times because it's brand new to them, because it is exciting to them, and all of that. But then time goes on and people tend to become relaxed in that relationship, and it tend not to mean as much to them as it did before. And unfortunately, that not only happens in marriage, but it also happens in our Christian walk, where if we're not careful, God can become common to us. The times that we spent with the Lord in worship and in prayer and in reading His Word, we tend to put that on the back burner and tend to think that it's just going to automatically flow, or what I like to call cruise. People put those things on cruise control. But of course, that's not God's will. The same effort that it took for you to get into that relationship with the Lord, as far as the time that you've spent with Him, the sacrifices that you've made for Him, it's going to take that same thing to continue in that relationship with the Lord. And we get a glimpse of that with Cain and Abel, how they were both doing their religious duties. Both of them were sacrificing to the Lord. Neither one of them really, naturally so, was offering a better sacrifice than the other. The problem was that only one of them was doing it by faith. Only one of them actually had a heart for God. And the one who had the heart for God, unfortunately, ended up getting killed by the one who did not have the heart for God. And so, years ago, when I was pastoring a church in Louisiana, it was my custom to go to the hospitals to pray for people. I had a lady in the church, and her only job, you know, was to advise me of who had went to the hospital or who needed prayer. And so I would go oftentimes to the hospital and pray for people, for the Lord to heal them. And so one day I was there. I just got finished praying for someone there, and as I was coming out and going back to my vehicle to go to church that night, a young man was passing by me, and the Lord spoke to me and said, "He's one of mine." And so as we passed by one another, he stopped me. He said, "Hey, you're a preacher, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes, yes, I am." And he began to tell me of the glorious things that God was doing in his life. In fact, he had just, a couple of weeks before, he had just dedicated his life to the Lord. And so he was, of course, in that state of being very excited, and, you know, God was brand new to him. And so after we left one another's company, I began to pray for him. Because he was telling me about what church he was going to, which, you know, of course, I didn't know anything about the church. But I understood this, that a lot of times people have zeal for God, and they'll go to a congregation sometimes where that zeal is taken from them. Many of you have experienced that on your own jobs, where when God first bless you with the job, you're excited, it's something new, you're glad that you have that job, you're glad about the opportunities, you're looking forward to moving up in that job, all of these things. But sometimes we make the mistake of talking to someone who's been there for 10 or 20 years. And they're telling you about all of the mess they've gone through, all of the messy people that are there, how it's not fair, how they can't stand their job, they hate life, marriage is suffering because of the job, and all of your zeal just gets let out. Why? Because their pain, their issues become yours. You begin to believe what they believe about it, when in actuality, it's really your mindset towards it. You see that? And so just like Cain killed Abel, that represented, it represents how people can kill the zeal that you have for God. And pretty soon you begin to live a relaxed Christian life, where now God is just a part of your life and not your life itself. Where at first, when you gave your life to the Lord, everything was based around God's word and what his word says. But now God's business in your life, God's salvation for your life is based around what's already going on in your life. And we'll give you a simple example. There are times when I'm driving down the highway, and I have yet to understand why the speed limit is only 55 on Briley Expressway, but that's what it is. And so I get on there, and it feels like I'm just crawling along. You know, and a lot of times when I get on Briley, I have a specific time to be somewhere. And it seemed like I'm the only one on the road that's obeying the law. And if you're not careful, it's easy to get caught up in the traffic like, well, Lord, everybody else is going 65 and 70. You know, apparently they, you know, if I just blend in with everybody else, I won't get pulled over. And of course, that's exactly when you get pulled over, you see. That cop will say, "Hey, you saved, so you're supposed to know better." But I think you all understand what I'm saying when I say that the temptation is there. Now, you know, some of us may think, well, that's not a big deal. Going 5 or 10 miles over the speed limit, that's not a big deal. But the Bible tells us to obey the law of the land. You don't have a testimony when you can't do the speed limit. If you can't keep man's law, you're not going to keep God's law. So when the speed limit says 55, that's exactly what it means. And I found that out, you know, when I was down in Louisiana driving, and I was on the highway, on the interstate at first, doing 70. And you know how it is when you're on the interstate doing 70, you feel like, okay, I'm going on with life. And then you get on one of these little back roads that's a highway, and it, you know, when you have to slow down to 55 or 45, it just feels like you're not going to get to your destination. And so I did, was doing 70, I think 72 in a 55 down this back road. Nobody was back there, so who's going to know, who's going to care? I'm just, you know, getting to my destination. Except it was a cop parked off the street somewhere. And he was coming, you know, he began coming in the opposite direction of where I was going. And I thought, well, surely he's not going to be able to clock me coming from this direction. Except when I looked in my rearview mirror, he turned around and came and got me. And so I got a ticket, you know, for, it was over $200 originally. And I'm telling you, when you get a ticket, you begin to think about all the things you could have done with that money. Now, a hard head would say, well, next time I'm going to be more careful. But when you belong to the Lord, you repent. You see, you repent. You don't make excuses for breaking the law of the land. You see, and you can't. You cannot follow God if you can't obey the law of the land. In the neighborhood that my wife and I, that we live in, it's against policy for us to wash our vehicle in the driveway. Yeah, it sure is. Can't wash your vehicle in your own driveway. I like boats, but it's against policy to have a boat parked in your front yard. It don't matter how pretty it is. Now, when my wife and I, when we bought this house, I had a boat. And I had to give the boat away. But you know, I had to come under subjection, even when I don't like the laws, even when, you know, they didn't send anybody here to talk to us about why we needed to keep it. We, you know, when we found out what the rules were, we had to obey that. Now, I'm going to tell you what happens whenever we don't obey. When you begin to compromise in one area, it opens up the door for you to compromise in other areas. Pretty soon, going 15 miles over the speed limit will turn into 25 miles over the speed limit. Based on your need, in other words. So you know what I had to do when I get on Briley? I have to make sure I leave home early enough to get to my destination to be able to keep the speed limit. I'm not going to leave 10 minutes later and say, well, I just make up for it, you know, in this section of driving. I had to begin to live like I believe God's word. You see that? I had to begin to live like that. So what happens whenever we break the laws of the land and we call ourselves believers? We'll lose our testimony. And you may think, well, nobody's watching me. Except they are. You may say, well, that the cop, you know, out there, he don't really know me. But how you know you won't run across him at some point and have to witness to him? What kind of witness are you going to have if you can't obey the laws of the land? And see, all of this goes along with what we're talking about, returning to our first love. It's a very slippery slope. When we begin to compromise in one area, the floodgates open to begin to compromise in other areas. And you can read about that in the life of Saul. God chose him to be the king over Israel. And he began to compromise little by little. When God first called him, he was so humble that he hid behind luggage because he was embarrassed about being the king. He felt like it was an honor that shouldn't have went to him. But you know, it went from that to him stepping in the priest's office to offer sacrifices when Samuel, the priest, didn't get there fast enough for him. So that was one compromise. And then it went from that to finally him just disobeying God altogether and not killing all of the sheep and all of the oxen and everything that was walking among the Amalekites. And from that, God snatched the kingdom from him. And if we're not careful, we can keep walking that thin line with the Lord. and think we're getting by until Satan comes over and push us over. And before you know it, you're completely on the other side and don't even realize it. Completely on the other side, lost, and don't even realize it. Let me tell you something. There's no such thing as once saved, always saved. There's a such thing as if you get saved, if you want to stay saved, you can remain that way. You see? But if there was a such thing as once saved, always saved, why would the devil tempt you after you get saved? If you couldn't lose your salvation after you got saved, the devil wouldn't bother with you. He would just allow you to live your life. Because after all, he's lost you forever. So you can lose your salvation. God does not take your free will away from you after you get saved. We'll never know salvation and walking with God the way that Adam knew it in this world. We'll never know it the way that Lucifer himself knew it. But when he crossed God, he sealed his fate. You see, and we can keep walking. You see, you belong to who you're walking with. And you can't say that you belong to God if you're walking with the devil every day. Now, I understand sometimes this is kind of hard to swallow. But, you know, this Bible tells us that we're to work out our own soul salvation. We're supposed to work that out. Jesus Christ told us to search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. But they are they which testify of me. And so this word is our map to help us to determine where we are in God. And when we find out that there's an area that can improve in our lives concerning God's word, we have to line up with that. We can't just continue to do what we want to do and think, well, God's going to excuse it. The Bible calls that turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. God's grace isn't there as you know, a free get out of jail card. If you keep sowing to the flesh, you shall of the flesh reap corruption. Hell is full of people that were sowing to the flesh, and it's full of folks that were in church their whole lives who thought, I can keep walking down this road. Nothing's going to happen to me. Sometimes we forget about God's command in the book of Genesis. He told them not to eat of that tree. Now, I'm going to tell you, do you know where Eve made her mistake at, and Adam as well? If God had told me not to eat of a tree, I wouldn't have been staring at it. I wouldn't have been looking at it to be tempted by it. And many of us, we think, I can look. God didn't say not to look. You see, she made the mistake of thinking, hey, that the sin began with her eating of the tree. It actually started in her heart when she began to lust after it. Your sin don't start when you sleep with somebody you're not married to. It begins when you begin to lust after them. It begins in your heart. Jesus said, if a man look upon a woman to lust after her, he has committed adultery already. You see that? And so we have to be careful with that. Let's not. You can't play with the devil and win. Because you can't beat the devil at his own game. He's been fooling people for thousands of years. And you think you're going to come along and outslick them? Jail is full of people that thought they were slicker than the law. And you know, unfortunately, if they don't get converted when they go to jail, they just learn from other older fools. I can do it better the next time. The last time I didn't know that they had an alarm. The next time I'm going to cut the alarm system, and that's going to, I'll beat it then. You see that? How can you escape a trap that the devil have set for you, and you walk right into it. The best thing to do is not to walk in the trap. Don't be trying to figure out how you can get out once you get caught. Just don't walk in it. That's all. And sin is a trap for people. Sin is a trap for people. And it represents where they are in their relationship with God. When you think you can play with sin, it's because you don't have the relationship with God that you need to have. Because God's people aren't looking for ways to break his laws and still get into heaven. God's people are not trying to justify their ways before him. This Bible tells us that if the righteous be scarcely saved, how much more the sinner and the ungodly? When you get to heaven, it's going to be by the skin of your teeth. The Bible says the righteous are going to scarcely be saved. The righteous. So you think you're going to bob in there with all that sin you carrying? But again, it represents our relationship with the Lord. My wife and I, when we first got married, and you all have heard me say this before, we had a very, very deep conversation. And she told me that she was in this marriage for life, that she took her vows seriously. So much so that if I had ever fallen into the sin of adultery, she would forgive me. Now, I didn't take that as a license to go out and see who I could sleep with. Now, I believe her when she says that. But that don't give me wandering eyes, you see. If I love her, I'm not going to do that. I know that her love and forgiveness is there for me if I ever fail. But you see, that my mind isn't even on anything like that. I don't take that and say, well, thank the Lord she's going to be there because I can't help myself. I knew that was the Lord speaking through her because he knows my struggles. But you know, that's what many believers do with the Lord. God, you know me. And the Lord said, I sure do. The Bible makes it clear. If we willfully sin, in the book of Hebrews, if we willfully sin, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. Don't get mad at the police when they pull you over and give you a ticket for going above the speed limit. Don't get mad at God or try to pray to the Lord that some kind of way he'll dismiss it and he'll just work it all out in your favor. Don't get on Facebook and talk about how the police is just hating on you because, you know, you just need to obey the law, that's all. And you need a pastor to tell you that. You need to obey the law. Apparently, some folks got plenty of money stashed to the side for speeding tickets. But unfortunately, there's no amount of money you can stash to the side for losing your soul. You see, there's no amount of money. And so God wants us to obey the law of the land. Trust me when I tell you, you know, it's not easy doing 55 on Briley Parkway. And then you got folks, not only are you feel like you're crawling along, like, you know, you're the oddball and you're the one that's crazy. But you got folks pulling up on side of you, throwing all kind of gang signs and mean mugging you. Like you're the one that's crazy. Like you're the one that's breaking the law by doing the speed limit. I just turn on my gospel music and just praise the Lord, everybody. And then every now and then I get somebody driving behind me. They may pull up kind of fast and then they'll slow down. I'll be like, I got another one saved today. Before it's all over with, we're going to all be doing the speed limit. But But what we're saying is, these little things that we consider little, they show us where we are spiritually. Everything that you see in the natural is a result of what's going on with you spiritually. The Bible says, that basically, in the book of 1 John, that the evidence of our love for God is our obedience to His commands. He said, and his commandments are not burdensome. It's not burdensome when you love God. It's burdensome when you don't love Him, but you're still trying to follow Him. It's not burdensome for me not to cheat on my wife, but it would be if I didn't love her. You see that? And that's where love comes in. God wants you to love Him, not just to obey Him, but to love Him. If you are married or if you've ever been in a relationship, you don't want the person that you're in a relationship with to do things with you or for you out of obligation, because you will be able to tell the difference. You'll know whether somebody's heart is in it. You see that? And many of you, you've heard me explain before, when my wife and I, when we first got married, she would shop. And she liked to shop. Not that she liked going out and spending all kind of money, but she liked going out browsing and seeing what was new and what had come out and things like that. And my mindset was, well, I love my wife. I'm going to be a good husband, and I'm going to go shopping with her. Except that was not my calling. I found that out real quick. I don't understand how somebody can just stand and just look and look and look. Because I grew up going to the store, knowing what I wanted to get when I got there, and just leaving. That's what it's there for. It's not there to hang out. And so I called myself being the good husband. I'm going to go shopping with my wife. And, you know, it's all going to be good. And I'm going to get some brownie points for shopping. Except it just was not my calling. Standing on my feet, just standing, just to be standing there. I've already put in that kind of time. You see that? And so she'd be shopping, and about maybe an hour or two into it, I'm huffing and puffing in my own way, letting her know I'm ready to go. And you know what happened? It began to cause more conflict if I just stayed home. And I just began to learn, okay, shopping's not my calling. I'm not going to pretend to like it. So I just, whenever she get that urge, I just let her go do that, and that's that. Even grocery shopping, you know, I don't believe.
We thank you again for tuning in to God's Truth and Deliverance broadcast. Prayerfully, this message has better equipped you for your spiritual journey. If you would like to submit a prayer request, you may submit your request by calling and leaving a message at 615-530-6138. Tune in next week, same station, same time, for more of God's Truth and Deliverance. Be blessed.